Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to CSI 2018. I am Professor Dr. G. R. Kane. I'm a professor at D.Y. Patil Medical College in Navi Mumbai, and I'm a consultant cardiologist at Hinduja Hospital, Mumbai. And I have two distinguished foreign faculty. They're Indian-born, but now in the United States, and are prolific interventional cardiologists in their own right. To my left is Dr. Ramesh Daggubati from New York, and to my right is Dr. Vijay Iyer, again from Buffalo, New York. Both of them do a large amount of complex interventions and even TAVIs and all other procedures. But today we are going to restrict our discussion to complex PCI, which includes CTO. They have just finished their talks in Hall B, and we would like to get to know more about their actual practice in this field in the United States. Welcome.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
My pleasure to have you here. Let me start with Dr. Daggubati. Complex PCI, what do you mean by complex PCI? What is your definition of a complex PCI?
You know, that's a very tricky question, because complex PCI for someone does may not mean complex for a different person. So in my own terminology, I think complex PCI is someone who has a heavy calcified coronary artery lesion that does not dilate well with just a regular predilatation balloon. And some people include under complex PCI left main, any bifurcation lesion, or a chronic total occlusion. All of these are considered as complex PCI.
Exactly. There doesn't seem to be one uniform definition. So how would you look at what is complex PCI for you?
So when I look at complex PCI, I look at two things. As I said in my talk, there is the complex anatomy and there is the complex patient. Complex anatomy is a lot of the things that Ramesh mentioned, left main, highly calcified lesions, long bifurcation lesions, tortuosity, all those things that make a procedure technically challenging. But clinically, there are complex patients. There are patients with low ejection fraction, patients with bad renal function, patients who have multiple medical comorbidities where the safety margin for error is very, very narrow. So to me, the combination of the two is what makes a procedure complex. It's both anatomy and patient characteristics.
Absolutely. I fully agree with that. Now, having said this as a definition, I know that any cardiologist can do any interventional procedure today. Things have become much easier with the number of available equipment and setups. But what would be the prerequisite for somebody to attempt a very complex PCI?
To me, there are two things. One, as you said, experience is the most important thing. That is critical. And that means being facile with multiple techniques and equipment. That is critical. Whether it be atherectomy, whatever be the choice of atherectomy, laser, rotational, or the newer one, shockwave, whatever it may be, that's fine. The facility with support devices, balloon pumps, impalas, whatever is available. But most importantly, looking at the whole picture and planning ahead, to me, is the most important thing. So I don't think there's anything that cannot be done by a well-trained interventional cardiologist, as long as they have the requisite equipment and the training for it.
Agreed, yeah. Well, good training, expertise, good facilities in your center, absolutely, availability of all the devices that are available to do this procedure, as you rightly said. Now, let's take up some of the issues of this complex PCI. Let's take up, you have done an angiogram, and you see some calcification. I would love to know, how do you assess that calcification? Can I do a balloon angioplasty on this, or do I need a rota on this, or what sort of anti-calcific treatment? How do you make that judgment on an angiogram? Because that's the first line of your investigations.
Yeah. I mean, angiogram is still gold standard for us to do any procedure as a prerequisite, but angiogram itself may not be able to assess the degree of calcification in that coronary artery. If you do see railroad tracks of calcium on either side of the vessel, that is considered as a severe calcification. But absence of that, railroad calcification on either side of the vessel does not mean that calcium is not there in that vessel. So you have to probably depend on some sort of imaging, whether intravascular ultrasound or optical coherence tomography, to accurately assess the calcification. And so I think, as we were saying earlier, in our training program, we classify lesions, complex lesions, as type A, B, C, and C being the worst of the worst, heavily calcified, long, tortuous, chronic total occlusion lesions. Why do we need to know also is very important, Dr. Kane, the incidence of periprocedural MI or complications from this procedure is much higher in a complex PCI as compared to a type A lesion. So both of us, we know, we are in our programs, so when we trained, we were only given a type A lesion in the beginning. The first 100 procedures might be type A, then we go on to type B, then we go on to type C. So training is very imminent to be able to do this complex PCI, whether you're including atherectomy or not. So I would actually put a balloon first, even in the calcified lesion based on an angiogram. If you do not have the facilities of IVUS or OCT, small balloon, a 2-0 balloon, if it doesn't pre-dilate, then that is going to be a rock of calcium there. That's a simple balloon test that can detect the calcium.
Yeah, in fact, we call that as a poor man's IVUS. You know, we actually put an NC balloon, which is of the similar diameter to the artery, and just do at a nominal pressure. Do you do that in US, or you all go for straight away for IVUS?
No, I think absolutely. I'd say 95% of operators would still use that as a marker. And geographically, sometimes you're 100% sure that you have calcium that is going to be undilatable. In those cases, it's fairly common to start with an atherectomy strategy. But in those cases where either you are unsure or you don't think you can even get an IVUS catheter through, this is exactly the practice in most places to take a smaller balloon and dilate it. And if it's undilatable, then plan the next step.
Yeah, in fact, you need to stop before you get an extensive dissection so that the other procedures don't become dangerous after that. So avoid a dissection and then plan what next. Now the problem, what I will tell you, what we face is, a lot of us are trained in doing rota and other atherectomy procedures, but many of the people get they don't like. They usually like to do balloon angioplasty because that's the commonest thing and they get away and that's the run of the mill and your bread and butter comes through a balloon angioplasty with a stent. So short of rota, what are the other things that are available to treat a calcific lesion today?
So I think obviously the cutting balloon and the scoring balloons, both are available. They often allow you to expand your lesion. Now, we have to remember, I think it's critically important as we start to deal with more complex lesions. Just because you do a complex lesion doesn't allow you to get away with a shoddy result. You still have to get a well-expanded stent. You have to make sure the minimal luminal area is good enough, that you're not going to get stent thrombosis, apposition is good. All of those things are critically important. So lesion preparation is extremely important. Whether you use a scoring balloon, a cutting balloon, or go beyond that to any of the atherectomy devices, that is a choice that the lesion will dictate. But there is not any room for laziness in doing that.
Absolutely, yeah. You need to get that stent well expanded.
That's correct.
The preparation is the key.
Is the key.
You just should never put a stent unless you have prepared the lesion well. That's the concept. Because many times, if you put a stent beforehand, before you go an undersized balloon and then put a stent, you'll end up unexpanded stent, and then whatever you do doesn't seem to work there. Yeah, then you'll end up in a big problem. Yeah.
I mean, we also have OPN balloons now. I think they are available in India more than actually in the United States.
So, can you tell us a little bit about this OPN balloon? I know it's not available in US, but we have it here, just available a few months back.
I had the opportunity to use it
OUS. So, what is this OPN balloon? Many of our audience may not have heard of it because it's just available.
Right. And the OPN balloon is a highly non-compliant balloon. It can go up to even 30 to 40 atmospheres. Yeah. Of pressure, it can break a large amounts of calcium. Obviously, most of the calcium is within the intima and media, so that calcium can be broken down with this OPN balloon. So these are high pressure, non-compliant balloons that can take into high pressures. So on top of that, if that does not work, which we are hoping that as clinical trials would prove, the lithoplasty or blood balloons, lithoplasty has been invented
by Todd.
Yeah, so
what is this lithoplasty? You can tell us something about lithoplasty?
So the concept of lithoplasty, actually those devices were first used, still being used in the periphery, is the concept that you can use shockwave, very similar to what you use in lithotripsy to break up kidney stones, for example. Use shockwaves to break calcium deposits which are in the intima and the media, allowing you to modify the plaque that way. So initial experience in Europe appears to be very positive so far. Obviously, we have no outcomes data yet, but I certainly anticipate that in the next 2 years, these devices will be available very
powerful. Yeah, I think the initial data came with disrupt coronary artery That's disease correct. One trial, and now the second, That's number correct. Two, is going on in Europe with about 120 patients. Yeah. So we eagerly await that. I again know that it's not approved in the US, so you can't use it, but the Europeans have started using it. And surprisingly, both these Opian balloon and the lithotripsy balloon, what they have shown is they have not seen extensive dissections or perforations. So far it has not been seen. So I don't know whether that will hold true, but we need to keep our eyes open. But the data at the present moment, you will agree with me, is quite favorable. And people who want to do only balloon, maybe these are the two options. And of course, I want to know, so how would you choose between a rota or an OSA or orbital atherectomy? How do you choose between the two?
So for me, the algorithm is fairly simple. I save orbital atherectomy for devices where I think rota is likely to be harmful. So very tortuous lesions where I think with the calcium is very, very eccentric, possibly leading my rota to go into the non-calcified segment. So those are the segments that I tend to use orbital atherectomy more often. Osteal lesions, I prefer rotational atherectomy over orbital atherectomy. Though with the orbital atherectomy, you can, as you say, drill backwards. So if you can get across the lesion, you can actually come back with the orbital atherectomy device. But in general, what happens in most practices is people use what they're most comfortable with.
Absolutely.
And I think that's the key, is that you got to be comfortable with one device as best as you can, and then you end up using that more often than not.
To the best of my knowledge, we don't have orbital atherectomy here, but usually one of the relative contraindication is osteal lesions.
That's
because
correct.
You have to start from outside and you don't know what will happen to
the Or you have to come across the lesion
and drill
backwards.
So what is the size of the rota that you use when you want to do rotational atherectomy? Your choice of size of the burr, or do you step burr, or you want to use only one burr? How do you go? Say vessel is 3.5 and extensive calcification.
That's very good. Contrary to everyone's belief, even in the United States, we are very cost effective.
Absolutely.
So we don't use a 1.25, then 1.5, then 1.75, and 2 burrs. All the burrs that are available maximum up to 2.25. So I start personally with a 1.5 rotor, and then I'll take a non-compliant balloon, and if I can get good dilatation of the lesion, then I'm done. If not, then I'll go with a 2 rotor burr.
So absolutely. That's what we do here also. We use a 1.5 or 50% of the size. And then we may use a cutting balloon or an NC balloon, depending on that, because we have found cutting balloon also helps. And then finally, an NC balloon 1:1 before you go with the stent. So the main thing is, please get the vessel prepared well. Yeah, that's the whole concept. Okay. Now, having said all this, now this is all blind. You have calcification, you are trying to use a balloon, then cutting balloon, then rota. You don't even know whether the calcification is intimal, it is deep. What is the depth of the calcification? What is the length of the calcification? So herein comes to me, or my mind, the importance of imaging in patients with complex angioplasties, where your result is vital to the survival of that patient. So I believe that imaging is essential in patients with complex angioplasties. And given a choice, if it is cost effective, I would love to use it in every patient. What would you say?
I completely agree, and I also agree that it is significantly underutilized, not just here, but worldwide. I think the data is very clear. The data is also fairly clear that outcomes are better when imaging is an adjunct to PCI. My personal practice is to use IVUS when I'm trying to assess the lesion, and OCT when I'm trying to assess the stent. So that's the principle. To your question, it is not uncommon for me to do a rotational atherectomy run followed by a quick IVUS image to see what kind of result do I have, what kind of vessel lumen size am I achieving, looking for. And then after the stent is deployed, not in every case, but many times, if it's a long lesion, use OCT to make sure that the stent is well opposed, well expanded, that there are no edge dissections, etc. So I think I completely agree that you need more imaging, especially the more complex the case. I have a rule in my lab, every left main gets an IVUS. It doesn't matter, you know, how easy or how complex, every left main gets an IVUS. So, I mean, I think it behooves all of us to, I think, use a little bit more imaging in our cases.
Yeah, I would agree with you, but I would love to know, like, you can't afford to do an IVUS and OCT. Maybe very few centers can have the luxury of doing both, because both have a little bit different utilities in a given patient. But what is your choice? You use OCT more or IVUS more? And yeah. I think the data is in IVUS is much more extensive as compared to OCT, though the pictures of OCT look gorgeous.
Right. I think that's absolutely. I don't use both of them in the same patient for the same lesion assessment or pre and post. So my choice most of the time nowadays is a OCT. OCT, except probably in osteal left main lesions, you can or osteal RCL lesions, you can actually do lesion assessment, the length of the stent that you want to choose, and everything has been very well shown in the Illumin 3 study that actually that we can do great job by OCT alone, and pre and post, as well as how is the stent expanded, the rendered stent, and the three-dimensional view. And very easy to identify dissections, much higher resolution as compared to IVUS.
Yeah, so what I wanted to ask you was now we have even 60 megahertz IVUS, and that gives you
good resolution.
Very good quality images, almost similar to OCT. The question that I have for you is, should one be doing an imaging before he puts in the balloon? Or should the imaging be done after you put the stent to assess? And what is the importance of doing it?
There are pros and cons of both approaches. I think the importance of pre-imaging becomes more important when you're uncertain whether you want to do plaque modification or how to do plaque modification. In those circumstances, IVUSing or imaging before, I think is extremely vital in deciding your strategy. In those cases where you've already made a decision to do plaque modification, whatever the strategy may be, I think you need to use IVUS to make sure that you have good results at the end of the case in terms of your stent expansion, apposition, edge dissection, etc. And again, what modality you use is probably not that critical at this point because there's not much data telling us that one is significantly better than the other. But it is critical that whatever modality you use, you're a real expert in it and you're very comfortable with it.
Absolutely.
So what, Ramesh, what has happened is that if you read the data, after the data on IVUS has been published, ADAPT-DS, you have the IVL, XPL stand, then you have the latest now all-comers IVUS data. So what they have found is that when you use IVUS, obviously the results are better and they have mortality benefit, MI benefit, restenosis benefit, but they have landed up using bigger stands, longer stands, and higher pressures. Mm-hmm. So how do you put it? So when we don't use that, we don't use all this.
No, that's a fantastic question. Actually, somebody recently asked me the same thing. Aren't we doing injustice by using longer stents? So that was an old dictum that we have said. It is better to put short stents, less restenosis. But in fact, what the ultimate study recently has shown in 1,400 patients, as you mentioned, the TLR and MI rates have been halved by using intravascular ultrasound from 8 centers in China as compared to angiography alone. And I also say that probably when you're using this catheter, it is better to use the IVUS or OCT for both pre and post. And even if you use a longer stent, it is better to stent the area from normal vessel to normal vessel so that you don't land in a plaque causing dissections or distal embolization and more problems. So I think long stent is okay as long as you put it in from a normal vessel to normal vessel that is shown by intravascular imaging.
Yeah. Now with this data, if you really see even in US, I know that the penetration of imaging is almost 80% in Japan, but there are reasons for it because they get reimbursement. In US, I, to the best of my knowledge, it's only about 15%, whereas in Europe, it is less than 10%. So in India, less than 10%. So if we have so much of advantages, you think in the near future, this is going to change?
I think so. I think as data are emerging that outcomes are impacted with imaging, you will see this more and more as part of our guidelines, wherein we're being sort of directed or being advised that you're better off using imaging. Guidelines have a very strong way of influencing our practice decisions, especially in the United States. And I think with the emerging data, till this point, till about a year, year and a half ago, we really could not make a very strong argument for using imaging as it was linked to outcomes. We had intermediate outcomes like MLAs and stent expansion, et cetera, but not hard outcomes. But now that we have some hard outcomes, you can certainly see that this is going to be driven to the point where more and more people will be using it.
Okay, now let's come to a different aspect. You have a patient of a complex PCI that you want to do. His ejection fraction is, say, 25%. Now, he's stable. So would you use a support device in this? So when do you really use these support devices, and which one do you choose, and why do you choose that one?
So for me, support devices are not purely a linear decision making. It's not everybody with a 25% EF doesn't need a support device. It depends upon what are you planning to do, how compensated is the patient clinically, what are the other risk factors around that patient that may allow you to do your procedure easily or not. For example, a 25% EF, but an ostial left main stenosis, I don't think requires a support device as long as you're not planning to do a big, long, complex atherectomy on that patient. If it's a simple in and out stent, that's exactly what it is. On the other hand, a EF of 25% with a distal left main bifurcation that's calcified, requiring a two-stent strategy and rotational atherectomy, is a completely different animal. In that case, I would prefer to have support. And my personal preference in these cases is to actually use an Impella device. Because while the balloon pump has a lot of experience, I don't believe it has a lot of data supporting. So therefore, my current practice for all of my high-risk PCIs is to use an Impella device. Depending upon the patient's anatomy, depending upon the iliac size, either a 2.5 device or an Impella CP device. That is usually my practice.
Okay, the Impella has just come back to our country. You know, we did not have it for a long time. It was there initially, but it's an expensive proposition. The Impella device cost around 14 to 15 lakhs if you want to put it. So does IABP help or doesn't help? What is your opinion?
So I take it a little bit differently. I also use a lot of Impella in the United States, but my decision making is based on their end diastolic pressures. I even if the EF is 25 and they're well compensated, I'm okay with actually doing without any support. But if I do use the support, I base it on a right heart catheterization. If their cardiac index is more than 1.8 and less than 2.2, I still go ahead with a balloon pump. And if it is less than 1.8 up to about 1.5 or so, then I think Impella is good. But if it is severe, meaning if you want to use any device in people who has a cardiac index of 1.1 or lower, and even if they are compensated heart failure patients, I would actually go for a larger device such as Impella 5.0 or a tandem heart in such patients.
I know, you do have those extra ECMO and all. So when do you use an ECMO? Have you done cases with ECMO?
We've done cases with ECMO where you need complete support, meaning not only do you need hemodynamic support, but you may need oxygenation as well. With the current technology that's available percutaneously, we very rarely put people on ECMO simply to do a percutaneous intervention. That's pretty rare. We do tend to use those when we have patients in cardiogenic shock where oxygenation is an issue, or in those patients where we have a true bailout strategy, wherein our plan is if the intervention fails, they're going to go and have bypass surgery. In those patients, we will put them on ECMO ahead of time.
One of the new things which we read was presented at American Heart in 2018, just a month back, or this month only if I'm not mistaken, by Naveen Kapoor from Tufts University. He talks about unloading the left ventricle before you do a palming. Yep. So instead of door to balloon time, he talks about door to unloading time. Can you just elaborate on this concept?
So we were part of the door to unloading trial. We enrolled about 6 patients in that study. The door to unloading trial comes from very solid basic science evidence that clearly shows that when you unload the ventricle in conjunction with a PCI or even before a PCI, you can reduce the size of the infarct. So the whole idea behind the door to unloading trial was what was presented at the AHA was a safety and efficacy trial. Because when we, for the longest time, we lived in the world of door to balloon. So even to propose that you're going to do something different from that, you have to show that you're not harming the patient, which is what this trial showed. But in the trial, it also showed, which is an exploratory endpoint, was outcomes related to those patients with the largest infarcts based upon ST segment elevation sum scores, that those patients seemed to have a lower infarct size by MRI when you looked at when they got unloaded before time. So the idea is that if you can unload the ventricle by using an Impella device, because that already shifts your pressure volume loop to the left, reduces your myocardial oxygen consumption, even in the setting of an occluded vessel. In fact, going back to the mid-1980s, there is data from Japanese groups that showed that if you occlude a vessel and you unload the ventricle, your infarct size is smaller than just occluding the vessel and reopening it. So there is some benefit to it on the basic science data, but hopefully the pivotal trial that's coming behind the DTU will address the
In
end.
Fact, one of the interesting that I found when I read that paper was when they waited for 30 minutes after unloading and then did the angioplasty, those results were better than doing an angioplasty immediately after unloading. So, and the concept is to prevent reperfusion injury, because if you immediately open it up, the reperfusion injury is higher. So we have, I think, discussed a lot about this. So now let's move on to a different talk based on his talk, is that chronic total occlusions. We'll just cover up a little bit. So I just want to know from you, for because you gave a talk to the sort of a fellows, or a, it was a tips and tricks. So how do you do an angiographic assessment of a CTO?
Yeah. So I think, number one, when you see a chronic total occlusion, don't try to do ad hoc PCI. You need to actually step back, maybe finish the angiogram, and advance another catheter through a femoral or transradial route, and do a dual injection to accurately assess the angiogram, or the chronic total occlusion on the angiogram. So then you come out of the room, you actually probably take off your lead, sit down, look at the angiogram, study it very well, very closely, and maybe take a help from other partners of yours. So we always recommend at least two people should look at the angiogram and discuss what is the best approach for that particular patient. So I always say dual injection is almost 100% has to be done, and take your time in assessing the lesion.
Yeah, I fully agree with that. In fact, you know, we have learned, most of us, I would say, have learned CTOs from the Japanese, and I have a few close friends who are big operators in Japan, and he keeps telling me, you have to see that angio for at least half an hour. See your plan A, then go for plan B, what will happen. You have to have a mental image of that CTO segment so that you can plan where your wire has gone as and when you start the thing. Most of us do mostly anti-grade, because by and large nowadays with the technology that is available, retrograde incidence is going down. Of course, it is important in some. Now, I just want to ask you a hypothetical situation. You see a microchannel, so you try to go with it. But it has been shown that even if you don't see a microchannel, usually there is one. So you can always try and anti-grade thinking that there is a microchannel.
Yes.
Do you believe in this concept?
Yes. I mean, anti-grade dissection or anti-grade wire escalation and trying to be in the true lumen itself is successful in about 2/3 of the patients. And that's why probably not every patient has to have a retrograde option or has to have anti-grade dissection re-entry. So you can probably be successful in a CTO PCI just by staying in the true lumen, true lumen itself.
Okay, now having started anti-grade, your wire distinctly goes into a false lumen. So how do you do a parallel wire? You just go with another wire, or would you like to use a dual lumen catheter? Do you think that helps?
Yes.
Or
so
how do you proceed?
Yes, I think in Japan they have shown Iyer guided re-entry, putting that wire in the subintimal space and using a Iyer guided re-entry with a second wire has been helpful. If not, I actually choose a second wire, parallel wire technique, trying to get into the true lumen with a different wire, which is usually Gaia first that I'll start off with.
Okay, yeah. So because there are different wires available, so how would you say one should get acquainted with all the different wires of different companies, or what is your philosophy?
I think if you go to my CTO card, it is technically impossible to get acquainted with every one of those
absolutely,
wires.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So I think every CTO operator needs to have a tool house of the wires that they're most comfortable with, but that means you need a broad spectrum of wires, from things that you can use to go subintimal to things that you can use to stay intraluminal. Get used to it, get comfortable, because it's not just the wire, but the feel of the wire, and you have to get used to it so that you can be safe. So certainly, I don't think it's feasible to know each and every wire in this day and age. So you have to find your toolkit and work with it.
So most of us learn from the Japanese, so we are very comfortable with the Asahi wires. You know, we have not seen the other wires at all,
right,
and they have everything under the sun. So you get used to one set of wires, and you require three or four wires. You require a wire which can take you through a softer plaque. You can have a wire with like Conquest Pro, which will take you through a hard thing. And you require in between an intermediate thing, which will give you, of course, knowledge of more wires is important. Now, having said that, in US nowadays you have this cross-boss and stingray technology. So when is that ideally to be done? What are the prerequisites for doing a cross-boss stingray type of a ADR?
Right. As you said earlier, when you don't see any microchannels and if you have a anti-grade dissection reentry option, which is with a blunt stump, you can actually loop the wire and push it down and or go with the cross-boss and go subintimal space, come out and finally find an area where you can re-enter in the distal vessel and use a stingray balloon to, which has almost like a two double lumen, and you can then pass a stiff wire, which could be a pilot 200 or the stingray wire itself comes in, and you can use that to re-enter the distal lumen, and then you'll be stenting from a true lumen and through a dissection plane into back into the true lumen.
What this is my personal, I wanted to ask always people like Kalyan Sundaram, we work sometimes together. So when you do this, you'll end up having a long area of subintimal stenting. Whereas the Japanese technology, what they try to do is, at least the, what they're teaching is to try to restrict that CTO zone to a minimum length. So they try to go retrograde rather than going extensively. So you have, you follow which philosophy or you have a compromise between the two?
No, actually, yeah, we switch back and forth very quickly. The whole idea is to shorten the time of CTO PCI. So as I mentioned in my talk, there is no strict anti-grade or retrograde. You should get rid of that idea. Well, the whole idea is to open up the vessel, whether anti-grade, if it doesn't work for 5-10 minutes, switch to retrograde and then come back to anti-grade if that doesn't work in another 5-10 minutes. So minimum amount of contrast, minimum amount of radiation, and high success rates can be achieved by following this specific algorithm that has been well written and published by Brilakis. And so we have now data even to say that even though you stent through the dissection, many of these patients never lost their side branches. They don't have worse outcomes than actually a retrograde mechanism. So the whole idea is to get the vessel opened up.
Vessel opened up, yeah. So is it a prerequisite that generally this is done when you have a blunt stump, you have a long segment to cross, but your distal vessel should be of good size and well seen so that you can make a good entry into this. So these are the three, prerequisites for that. So when would you think that, no, this is a patient where I will directly go for retrograde? Is there any chance like that? Is there any cases like that?
Obviously, when you study the angiogram, if you see a beautiful, large channel retrograde and filling up the whole vessel, I think the choice actually should be starting off with the retrograde in that particular patient. And you can see that there may be a hard, heavily calcified stump, which is short, but the retrograde channel is good. It is better to do it because anti-grade, the calcium cap is much more, proximal cap is always harder than actually going through a retrograde and a distal cap. So I think that success rate is much higher with the retrograde, and you should stick to that.
Absolutely. I fully agree with that. So, of course, we can go on and on and on, but I would like to conclude this session now. And gentlemen, thank you very much for conversing with me. And what I can say as a concluding part is that it is possible to do almost every angioplasty and open up any vessel under the sun that is given to us. But if that has to be done, the cardiologist who wants to do it should get himself trained properly, have himself equipped properly so that you have all the equipment to do the case as well as deal with any complications that might arise, have imaging and other facilities available to you, and have all the armamentarium, because as they say that people who have everything are the people who are likely to succeed. Otherwise, you may succeed sometime, but at some other time you may fail miserably, and that will be a big setback. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for your...
Thank you. Thank you for having us.